the Lord at all times, and his praises shall continually be in my mouth. Oh, blessed be God. We're glad to be back, hallelujah, here at Your Divine Appointment, which is the media ministry of the Divine Jackson MD Ministries. I'm Dr. Jackson, and today we're in class called Thursday School, which is Sunday School on Thursday. Praise God, his word is good every day. We bless the Lord. Thank God that you're joining us. We want you to know these recordings are available on our various social media platforms, available to you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. I encourage you to tell others about it. Amen. Would you so kindly on Facebook give us a thumbs up, like this video, and click share and share it with at least 2 people each week? Would you do that? And then on YouTube, would you kindly subscribe? That'll raise our rating. Plus, you'll be notified whenever new videos go up. We not only have Thursday School, but we have other presentations. And of course, we have daily postings on YouTube, in the community tab, as well as on these various social media platforms, all of it about the Savior, to get the word out. And will you pray with us to that end? Praise God. Well, today is something quite special. We're talking about the Savior. Today is Christmas Day. Happy birthday, Jesus. If we had time, we'd take the time and all sing happy birthday song to the Savior. Oh, if he hadn't come, where would we be? Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. Glory to God. So we're delighted to be here on December the 25th, 2022. And the lesson is about the wonderful rejoicing of his mother, Mary. The subject is Mary rejoices. And there's some richness in this passage. And we want to certainly delve into that. We bless God for the privilege. Lord, bless us now as we study your precious word. The word's already blessed. Asking you to bless us with an understanding and a transformation. This we pray in Jesus' name. Bless my brothers, sisters, and friends all around the world. We're remembering and celebrating that you sent the Savior. And Lord, we appreciate it. We give you glory for it. In the sweet name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Well, glory to God. Here we are, the book of Luke. We're in chapter 1, verses 46 to 55. And I hope you have your Bible with you, because we will need to look at a few passages in other parts of the sweet word of God. Well, the lesson opens here, verse 46 of Luke chapter 1. And Mary said, my soul doth magnify the Lord. Well, our soul can magnify whatever it chooses. Some people magnify their losses, magnify the failures of their past, magnify their current troubles, magnify those in political power and whatever else, or magnify themselves and how great they are and celebrate, and a lot of pride and self-worship. Mary says, my soul doth magnify the Lord. Oh, let's join in with her and let's magnify God. Oh, yes, he's the one that deserves it. And of course, to magnify something, just like a magnifying glass, is you make it larger. Well, you make it larger in your eyes. You make it larger in your view. The item is the same size it always was. The magnifying glass just makes it larger for you. God is already enormous and great and powerful and mighty. But when we choose to magnify him, we see him larger in our eyes. And as he is enlarged, other things are cast out of our view. Because when you have one thing that is so magnified, there's not room to see all this other. It falls to the peripheral vision, to the side, but the focus is made large. God needs to be made large and grand in our eyes, so we're focused on him. Can we magnify the Lord? Oh, bless his name. Glory to God. Well, somebody said, instead of telling God, well, we still need to do it, but instead of telling God so much about your troubles, tell your troubles about your God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Well, Mary says, my soul doth magnify the Lord. Verse 47, and my spirit has rejoiced in God my salvation. Wow, that's rich. Now look at this word rejoice. This word rejoice, when I looked it up, we know that usually when we say rejoice, just, you know, happy, glad. But this is an exulting, incredible, overflowing type of joy. This is the kind where you leap for joy. That's what she's talking about. Oh, will you leap with me? Oh, let's dance before the king. She said, my soul is rejoicing and leaping and giving God great praise. Look at verse 48. For he has regarded the low estate of his handmaiden. For behold, look at this, from henceforth all nations, all generations are going to call me blessed. This first part of the lesson that we just ended is Mary's celebration. This last part of the lesson is her worship and praise. And this celebration here is God is, I'm magnifying him. I'm incredibly rejoicing in him. And she goes on to say that some of this great celebration is just knowing I'm a handmaiden. And that's a term for a female slave, a female servant. She's not trying to consider herself something great. I'm just God's servant. And God has looked on me and blessed me. Oh, glory to God. And then she says, not only that, but he looked on the low estate of this handmaid. Now, I'm not just a servant or a slave, but my low estate. And a lot of times that term was used to refer to a person who was a poor or lacking in wealth, not of high position, not well known, not famed, and not celebrated and honored of people. I'm of a low estate, praise God. But the Lord chose a handmaid, a slave, who's of a low estate, not famed. And he blessed me. Oh, all of us, my God, can celebrate knowing that God does not measure things like man does. And we'll be looking at some scriptures that speak to these matters in a few minutes. Glory to God. So that is her celebration. And just before we go into her worship in verse 49, let's pause for our Bible spotlight. Glory to God. Bible Spotlight, we are continuing our study of the Great Commission of the Church in four passages. We covered Matthew 10, 8. We covered Acts 1, 8. We covered Mark 16, and now we're in Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 through 20. And please go back if you missed any of it. The last several weeks we've been in Matthew chapter 28 on that verse 19, which says, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them all things whatsoever I have commanded you. This teaching, this last part, that's verse 20, teaching them all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. Wow, the Great Commission. Glory to God. So we've been looking at baptism over these last many weeks. So we talked about the fact that there are three different techniques for baptism. We finished those. And now we're looking at the three different types of baptism. There's baptism into the body of Christ. There's baptism into water and baptism into the Holy Ghost. The baptism into water, in terms of that, we dealt with that on last time, that for each of the baptisms, there is a candidate, which is somebody who's ready for that baptism. B, there's an element into which they're being baptized. And C, there is the baptizer, the person who's carrying out the baptism. So we dealt with that for water on last week. Today we want to look at the baptism in the Holy Ghost. Amen? Now the first of these, of course, is being baptized into the body of Christ. That's more extensive scriptures. We'll be picking that up in a later week. But here we want to begin looking at the baptism in the Holy Ghost. First of all, the Holy Ghost and the Holy Spirit, we use those terms interchangeably. The term Holy Ghost is more specifically used in New Testament as opposed to sometimes in the Old Testament. There may be the term Holy Spirit that is used depending upon translations that are used. They're identical in terms of who they refer to. Amen? The Holy Spirit, that's God's Spirit. It's the Spirit of truth, called the Spirit of Christ, called many other things, the Spirit of righteousness, many names. Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit, referring to one and the same. Now, some persons, you might say in terms of the use of the term and the timing, would say that the ghost, Holy Ghost term, is more so after the resurrection of the Lord Jesus from the dead, because now it is, you know, because when you think of a ghost or a spirit, it's after a person has passed away. And so they say that that term Holy Ghost is more so used after the resurrection of Jesus from the dead, whereas prior to that time, the term Holy Spirit. Some may make that division or not, but we want to be clear. Whether you say Holy Ghost or whether you say Holy Spirit, referring to exactly Same person. Amen. Holy Ghost is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the Holy Ghost. Now, the baptism in the Holy Ghost. Now, we're looking at A, who is the candidate? B, what is the element about who they're being baptized into? That's the Holy Ghost. And then C, who is the baptizer? Let's start with A. A is the candidate. Who is the candidate to be baptized in the Holy Spirit? Well, in order to talk about that, we got to talk about what we mean by baptism in terms of the Holy Spirit. And that we'll touch on today, and we'll have to pick up the rest of it on our next session. One of them is some people separate out the term baptism in the Holy Ghost, being filled with the Holy Ghost, and some people use them interchangeably. Some people talk about baptism in the Holy Ghost versus baptism with the Holy Ghost. And so the terminology can get to be a little bit confusing. But what I will do, and there's different views on things, but what I want to present is a general principle. Help me say general principle. General principle here, let's look at baptism in the Holy Ghost versus being filled with the Holy Ghost. Well, we already defined that the word baptism literally means immerse, which is to take something and put it down into something else. An example may be if we have a sink full of hot soapy water and we have a coffee cup, when we put the coffee cup down into the water and it sinks down to the bottom of the sink, that cup has water all around it, it has water on it, and it has water in it. And so it is completely encircled in water. This soapy water that's in the sink. When we talk about baptism in the Holy Ghost, some people say that there's a difference between the Holy Ghost being inside and being completely full of Him, being filled with the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost, versus being baptized in the Holy Ghost. Now, there are separations and divisions of those. Some people have some very lengthy descriptions as to why, but let me share this principle. And that is, we see other descriptions of this experience with the Holy Ghost. Sometimes it's called being clothed upon, as if someone took a huge blanket and threw it over a person. And they are completely covered, wrapped up, enveloped, and holding inside the blanket. That's one picture of the Holy Ghost baptism. Another picture that people use is we see in St. John 7, 35 to 38, that passage, the Lord Jesus is at the feast, the great feast of tabernacles, I believe it is. And Jesus said, "Everyone that thirsts, come to me." And he says in that passage that the Spirit of God, the Holy Ghost, is going to be in them a well of water springing up to life. So if you're thirsty, come to me because I've got something for you. The Holy Ghost will be this well of water. So the other picture, other than the blanket, the other picture is if someone has a faucet and has a cup, you put the cup underneath the faucet. You turn on the water. And so the water starts going in the cup, and it fills it up, 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 until it's all the way up, and the water is brimming on the top of that cup. At that particular moment, the cup is completely filled. But since the term baptism means to be immersed, to be completely immersed in a thing, you'd have to put one more drop of water, and now the water overflows and it runs all down around the sides of the cup. Now the cup is full inside, it's full on the surface, and it is completely surrounded by the water. The principle, and that's what we're dealing with, the general principle of being filled with the Holy Ghost, being baptized in the Holy Ghost. People contend on terminology, and as you know with me, I don't just chase down all the different terminology. They can use it. But here's the principle. The scripture says in Ephesians 5:18, be filled with the Spirit. That means to be spirit controlled. Whether you want to use the description of the blanket or whether you want to use the water that goes up, 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 up until it all the way around, either of those you want to use, we seek that experience where we are filled and on the outside baptized completely enveloped in the Holy Ghost so that he becomes our leader. We are spirit controlled. Because that passage in Ephesians 5:18 said, don't be drunk with wine, wherein is excess. What does being drunk with wine happen? The wine becomes the controller. The person's behavior is dictated by the wine. He said, instead of being wine controlled, be filled with the Spirit. Be spirit controlled. Hallelujah. We want God to fill us up, brim, run us over, envelop us totally, throw the blanket on us, envelop us, overthrow, overcome us, clothe upon us, baptize, all of it, Jesus. Do it all. Amen. That's the experience that we want so that we're spirit controlled, whatever terminology. We want to be overflown, enveloped, and spirit controlled. Why? Because Acts 1 and 8, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And ye shall be witnesses unto me. He names all the places. And he ends up with the uttermost parts of the world. We need the Holy Ghost for the power to be the witness. Otherwise, we'll never fulfill the commission of Christ. We need the power. Oh, glory to God. Bless his name. And we'll pick that up again on next time. Glory to God. All right, darling. Finishing up our lesson here. Back to verse 49. Last part of our lesson, look what Mary says in her worship and praise. She says, for he that is mighty. If you have your pen, there are eight things that she declares relating to the Lord. Eight things. One, he's mighty. Two, he's done great things. Three, he is merciful. And that mercy is forever. Hallelujah. And so four is that mercy is forever. Number five, he has great strength. Number six, he's a judge. Glory to God. Number seven, he remembers the poor. And number eight, he remembers his promises. Glory to God. Now let's look at these. Number one, for he that is mighty hath done to me great things, and holy is his name. The Lord has done a mighty thing, taking a person of low degree. Usually in that day, particularly people that were thought to be blessed, and we'll deal with that more, are people of high estate, fame, blue bloods, their royalty, queens, kings, princes, princesses, magistrates and principal, their over principalities, all of these. I'm none of that. But yet the Lord has blessed me. He's done mighty things and he's done great things. Glory to God. And of course, might refers to you just got the strength to do it. But great talks about what the thing was you did. Sometimes people are strong, but what they're doing is not great. Glory to God. Verse 50, his mercy is on them that fear him from generation to generation. God is merciful, and we bless him for that. But the fact that she mentions generation to generation points to the scripture in the psalm, because his mercy endureth forever. Amen? What is it? Psalm 136, all through it. For his mercy endureth forever. For his mercy endureth forever. For his mercy endureth forever. In Lamentations chapter 3, and 22 through 23, talks about how every morning, God's mercies are new every morning because his compassions fail not. And of course, great is his faithfulness. His mercies are new every morning, every day, new mercies from the Lord. Thank God for that. Now, look at verse 51. She says, he has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. Let me flow into the next one. That's how he's a judge. Look at the next one. He has put down the mighty from their seats and exalted those that are of low degree. Ah, and then the next one goes with it, 53. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent empty away. So six is the judge. Seven here is remembering the poor. His remembering of the poor in verses 52 and 53 have to do with how he has elevated the state of the poor and the rich. Cast away. He has elevated those that have been counted out and others and cast away. Why this is important takes us back to the scripture where John the Baptist says that the low valley shall be raised up, the high mountain's gonna come down. God is the great equalizer in terms of righteousness. rich or poor. We're not against rich. We're not for poor. We're not against poor. We're not for rich. That's not how holiness works. Holiness is for everybody. Hallelujah. Rich or poor, known or unknown, royal blood or a commoner, no matter who we are, righteousness is for everybody. The reason this is so important is they're under Roman domination. And under Roman domination, those that have the power and have all those titles and positions I spoke about, they were dominating those that were poor. And not just the Romans, but other nations all over. That's how they operate. Mary's saying, listen, I'm a low degree and I'm a slave, and God chose me. He has highly exalted. And this is what God's, this is what Mary said, this is what God's doing now, choosing those that man would not choose, blessing those that man would not bless, elevating those that man would never elevate, and those that are elevated in themselves out of pride, God's pulling them down. Mary saying God is doing a great turnaround. Oh, glory to God. And this is a beautiful rejoicing that God turns the tide. Many of you now are suffering under the hands of oppression and people that are beating you down and dominating and taking advantage and abuses and things. God is doing a great turnaround. Hallelujah. He's the great equalizer because his love's for everybody. Everybody. We're going to look at some verses to prove that in a moment. Glory to God. Look, and then 53, he's filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he sent empty away. Amen. Satisfying our soul. Look at number 8, 54. He has hoped or helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy. This part about remembrance is God's keeping his promises. God promised Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob all these generations later. Here we are. God is keeping his promise and restoring his people. And now the Savior has come, Messiah, who we've waited for all this time. He's here. So what a celebration Mary puts forth. Now let's look at some other verses that help us as we elucidate this. Let's look at Luke chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. It says, every valley shall be filled, every mountain and every hill shall be brought low. Right? The valley's going to be filled, mountain hill brought low. The crooked is going to be made straight, and the rough places are going to be made smooth. Glory to God. This is the great transformation. High down, down up, rough smooth. All of these transformations. Amen? Let's look at the next one. Let's go to James chapter 3 and verse 17. Now, this is important because you'll see in this verse, it says, but the wisdom that is from above, the wisdom of God, because the wisdom from the earth is evil and it's sensual and it's devilish and it's ungodly. But look at verse 17. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then it's peaceable, it's gentle, and it's easy to be entreated. Look at this. Full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. The earlier verses, time won't allow now, talk about the wisdom of the ways of this world. But this is the wisdom of God. All of these precious, beautiful things without partiality, neither hypocrisy. Those are not the same. But the key we want to focus on is God is not partial. And as his children, we shouldn't be either. Oh, glory to God. Book of James talks quite a bit about that type of an attitude of partiality should not be in the house of God. Look at our next passage. Let's turn to Isaiah 61 and 1, and that connects with Matthew 5 and 5. Isaiah 61 and 1, this is the great prophetic about the Lord Jesus. It says, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because he hath anointed me, and look at this now, anointed me to preach good tidings to the meek. What? Who's worried about the meek? We want the strong, the powerful, the dominant, the... No. To preach to the meek. And then sent me to bind up the brokenhearted. Who's worried about the brokenhearted? The Messiah is. And to proclaim liberty to the captives. The captives. And opening a prison to them that are bound. What? Who's concerned about them? And on it goes. So even the prophetic about the Messiah is looking at those that are low, that God has come to them. And the Lord Jesus reads this very scripture when he opens his ministry there in Nazareth. Turned in the book of Isaiah, they had it in the scroll. He turns to the part where it's written, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me and anointed me to preach the gospel. And he said, this day, this scripture is fulfilled. One passage says in your ears, another one says in your eyes. Listen, it's fulfilled. Messiah has come to the poor, the brokenhearted, the captive, the bound. Wow. Mary's celebrating. Listen, Be encouraged. Others counted you out. Don't worry. They counted wrong because God counted you in. Oh, glory to God. Look at the Beatitudes. Jesus, when he launches his ministry, Sermon on the Mount. This is his first sermon now. In his first sermon, 5:5, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. What? According to man's standard, the meek not fitting to get nothing. You all don't mind Ebonic. The meek aren't going to get anything. You get things by dominating and taking advantage and manipulating. And No. God is coming. Oh, and the meek are going to inherit the earth. Let me end with this. Many people believed if you were down, if you were poor, if you didn't have, you were cursed of God. But if you were rich and if you were high and if you were powerful, you were blessed of God. A lot of that is the economy of earth. That's not God. We find here when we look in John chapter 9 and verse 3. There was a blind man, and the disciples asked the Lord Jesus, who did sin, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Well, I mean, the baby was in the womb. How could he sin? He's born blind. But the disciples reflected the thought of the day, which is that if you had trouble or you were in lack or you had a need or whatever, or you weren't high up, if you weren't rich, you were cursed, and if you had, you were blessed. But Jesus said, no, that's not how this works. Jesus said, neither this man or his parents is the cause of his condition. Jesus said, it's that the works of God should be made manifest, make known. It's so that the power of God can be revealed, so God can show his love and mercy for all. Hallelujah. And after teaching the disciples, he didn't stop there. He went down and healed the man to let them know, listen, no, he's a candidate for healing. Oh, yes, he is. Why is he a candidate for healing? Because he's a soul. Oh, glory to God. Precious saints, we need to keep this. There's another scripture. Time won't allow. Go into all the scriptures. Another scripture says that in the last day, men would say that gain is godliness. Just because you have this world's goods doesn't prove you're godly. Because the question is, how did you get it? And just because you're lacking and poor, that doesn't mean you're godly either. Because you can be poor and ungodly. You can be rich and ungodly. Which lets us know the status measurement of this world is not the measurement of status in the righteousness of God. The Lord Jesus invites all, rich, poor, royalty, commoner, even a handmaiden who's a servant. Come unto me, all you that labor, heavy laden, I'll give you rest. Hallelujah. Take my yoke upon me. I'm meek and lowly of heart. My yoke is easy, my burden's light. Matthew 11:28. Precious ones, thank you for joining us for this precious study. Thank you for celebrating Christmas along with me so we can celebrate it together. Father, we love you and bless you. Thank you for your son. Thank you for my brothers, sisters, and friends that have joined us. What a wonderful day. If you haven't made Christ your Savior, do it right now. Receive Jesus. We're celebrating his birth. He came for you that you might have eternal life. Father, we bless and praise you for this in Jesus' name. Remember this, the God of the Bible, he's real. Hallelujah. Prepare for your divine appointment with him because it's coming. God bless you till we meet again.